my black people. It's all about the unity. There's nothing they can do with us, so ain't nobody move for me.
Warning. Stand by for countdown. Prepare audience for maximum impact. Full immersion begins in.
It's your clothing. Y'all just keep it going.
Black people too try to suppress our determination to achieve liberation. Like Angela Davis said, it's built into the system.
Nowadays I can't believe what's going on in front of me. I don't want to watch TV and find another casualty. I don't want to read the news. My heart's already black and blue. I'm putting on my combat boots, 'cause I got an attitude. We're like soldiers forced to fight a war. What the hell? I can't take it anymore. 'Cause for so long we've been patient, now we're done. Don't you even ask me, when did I become such an angry black woman? In the air, we keep praying for a miracle, 'cause every day is a struggle. But as long as my brothers and my sisters are in trouble, goddamn, I'm an ABW.
We can't successfully put an end to racial discrimination until we change the entire system.
We've been trying to keep the peace 50 years since Martin King. Some don't like me for who I am, but I love my melanin. Another future college grad. Soldiers forced to fight a war. What the hell? I can't take it anymore. 'Cause for so long we've been patient, now we're done.
It's your clothing. Just keep it going.
They see something that I don't see. What can you learn from a bum, Omar? Shamsuddin? What I learned from a bum, maybe it's what not to do.
Nope. Nobody takes down Angel Snuff Nuff 7 easy. There's a reason why, after 100 channels destroyed, Angel Snuff Nuff 7 is still here. There's a reason why nobody want to get in a beef with Angel Snuff Nuff 7. But you don't take me seriously.
This is a story about control. My control. Control of what I say and control of what I do. And this time I'm gonna do it my way. I hope you enjoy this as much as I do. Are we ready? I am. 'Cause it's all about control. And I've got lots of it.
jazz. I want that. Oh, I need that. Got to have that. It's mine.
I can't describe all the
to life, back to reality, back to life, back to reality, back to life, back to reality, back to the here and now, yeah.
What was that you said to me? Don't say it was nothing. You cannot lie to me. Your eyes were talking. In the way you wear your smile, and in the way you wet your lips, it's enough to drive me wild, and I cannot take much more of it. So
tell me a secret we'll share. What is on your mind?
Tell me a secret way.
Tell me a secret wish and I will tell you mine.
Yes, I'd like to talk to you. Take some of your precious time. I'd like to get to know you. Would you be so kind and do?
Tell me a secret wish and what is on your mind.
Tell me a secret way.
Tell me a secret.
Only talk to me. can't hide your thoughts. You cannot pretend with me. I can feel the thunder. I can hear your heartbeat. Come a little closer to me. Don't be afraid. I will not bite. I'm not such a bad girl. Only longing for the night.
Tell me your secret wish and what is on your mind. Tell me your secret wish and I will tell you mine. Tell me your secret wish and what is on your mind.
I'm saying that the Nation of Islam should evolve into what we call the Reality's Temple on Earth. You don't need no Arab hand-me-down religion. You don't even need God. You don't need these things. That's good for us in our infancy, in our immaturity, when we was babies. But as we grow and mature, and even in religion itself, it says that we are the children of God. Children can't stay children forever. Children must become adults. So if we are the children of God, that means we become God. Act like God, move like God, and have the responsibility of a God. Dragon Manifest. Welcome to the Reality's Temple on Earth, Dragon Manifest.
Thank you for having me, brother. This is an honor. When I first saw your channel, I said, oh, this is an ancestor that has most definitely returned. Yes. Most definitely. This is not a new ancestor. This is an old ancestor. you could hear, you could feel the ancestors through you. You know, most people probably say, what is he talking about?
Right.
They don't get it. You gotta be on that level.
If you say that I'm divine and I'm a prophet, where the hell did your ass go to? Why aren't you heeding the call? Since I'm a prophet, since I'm divine. Some people, excuse the language, some people just like talking out their ass. 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 That's what they like to do.
Peace forever and always. My black people, it's all about the unity. There's nothing they can do with us, so ain't nobody moving.
What's the system trying to debate anger stuff themselves? There's many people, they want to debate and get angry at me. You can't debate me. You're cutting pace.
The Reality Temple on Earth.
Shout out to the Reality Temple on Earth on IG.
We love watching it.
Yeah, we really do.
We send love, peace, and soul.
Good evening, soul brothers and sisters. This is Tanji Cox, the Black Sheep. And I am propositioning you to entertain just a little while of being in reality. And this is going to hurt soul sisters and brothers because a lot of us cannot accept reality. I empower you to, for 1 year, to subscribe to the Reality Temple on Earth. And at the end of 12 months, draw your conclusion of what have you learned in that amount of time. I empower you. You will never, ever, ever think, feel, or entertain nonsense ever again, period. I would like to see my soul sisters and brothers awaken. This requires time. You need to spend about a year watching, researching, and looking. Reality Temple on Earth is life-changing, and I stand on that.
The deacons of Reality
put out a short video and talk about winning. I don't like losing. I really don't. I'm very competitive. I don't like losing. Some people don't mind losing. Oh, it ain't nothing but a game.
Ride, let's get this party started quickly.
Terry, it's so good to see you. Thanks for dropping in. When you get a chance, look up Soul. Thank you for that. Let's see, Talik says, can you shout out to my form, the Real on Earth Internet Ministry. Our theme this year is After Purge comes the sub out to you. All the best to you guys with continuing to stretch in perspective, to stretch in what is possible, and to continue to bring healing into the space of yourself and others. Yes.
The game begins in 3, 2, 1. Thank you.
Morning, y'all. Welcome to another sleepy, because I'm half asleep here. I did not expect to be broadcast early this morning. I had no idea, had no plan. So not only is this a spontaneous broadcast for you, but it's a spontaneous broadcast for me too, because I had no idea that we would be going live this morning. But I was contacted by our brother Denzel, who wanted to come here and talk about this particular topic. And so that's what we're going to do this morning. I appreciate all of those who are decided not to go to church this morning. because you decided not to go to the mosque or the synagogue or to the liquor store this morning, so that you would be sober enough to listen to this broadcast this morning. I appreciate that you can take a little time out of your busy schedule to participate in this conversation. I appreciate it. It's always an honor. This morning, we want to talk about, general discussion, but the main thing that we want to talk about is Brother Denzel wanted to talk about how could we take advantage of gang members in our community or the criminal element in our community so that they would, instead of always being so detrimental to us, they would be beneficial. So I don't know, we don't have anybody here that got the information, a history buff that could tell us the actual history of those different things, because this element has always been in our community for a long time. And in some cases, it's been very detrimental. And in some cases, actually, in a way, very helpful. And we're going to discuss that this morning. And we're going to, I'm going to turn the mic over to get us started to the brother who brought this topic to us. And I was hoping that you had this guest, Brother Denzel, that you was telling me about, but I guess they chickened out or whatever. I don't know. Anyway, you can talk and explain that. We're going to turn the mic over to Brother Denzel. Brother Denzel, welcome again to this platform. Appreciate it. Let's give Brother Denzel a round of applause. You're breaking up.
How you doing, Andrew Snubnub? Peace to the chat, too.
All right.
Can you hear me?
Loud and clear on my side.
No. Well, how your day going, man? I know I, woke you up, I just wanted to have a conversation about this. I don't know if you can see me or not because my screen green, but I guess it ain't working, but that's fine. I was thinking about it one day, and I was listening to Pharaoh sometimes while I'd be doing a lot of, other activities. And I was wondering about, the idea of deputizing OG gang members to help deal with the young ones. Because I think like it's different kinds of like violence in the black community. It's just the gang violence is just separate. Then it's also domestic, then robberies. But the gang violence is revenge killings. Mm-hmm. So for that, I usually talk to OG gang members. And I remember, I think I talked to y'all about that before, but a lot of them that I talked to, they told me that they can't get into that or try to stop them because they said they have to kill them or they'll end up killing them. And I think they know this. So I was thinking about how the Mississippi campaign, we can use it. It's basically using the law in our favor to help us, or help future generations down the line. And I was wondering, because, I remember when you were saying if we somehow got the Mississippi campaign up and running, right? And let's say, for instance, somebody in another state have been locked up for wrongful reasons, if it can be proven that they was wrongful and they ain't been able to get out. Well, like you said, we could have our own court system, or we can have our own laws in place to stop them from locking somebody up that was wrongly, justly locked up. And I was thinking one day, like, you know, the OGs I talked to, since they got a criminal record, you know, they got a lot of stuff in place that's, you know, stopping them from doing, like, from living.
Yeah.
You know, and it's this guy recently, I've been helping him a lot. He got locked up again, but he was, you know, he didn't have his driver's license, and you know, he got pulled over and he got locked up. But he was doing the right thing. He was going to work, but I don't think he should have drove.
Uh-huh.
But the reason I'm telling you this, because I think the Mississippi campaign could be like a good instrument we can use, because what if it was a way that we could use that to, like, somehow, like you said, if we have our own laws in place, we can make it so to where we can get some of their cases expunged, you know, mm-hmm. make life easier for them so that, you know, they'll be able to live, and then they can pass that on to their kids. But I think, you know, if we can be there for them, you know, then they can be able to deal with the younger ones. Because I do listen to Pharaoh sometimes, and some of the things just start clicking in. It's funny how y'all say similar things. Y'all ideas click together so well. I don't know why, you know, he wouldn't, like, I don't know why he can't understand the Mississippi campaign, because it goes hand in hand with what he's talking about. And you know, I was thinking, like, if we give them something, like, they can be able to, like, let me start by saying this. I believe personally that black people have to get on the police force. We have to police ourselves.
Uh-huh.
But I was thinking, before we do that, because I don't think black people, I know some young black people that's got on the police force. But it's not like, okay, it's not like you may get like a large amount. But I think it should be a form of inspiration. Because if we can deputize the gang members, then we can somehow, you know, like, let's say, for instance, because most of the time people can't go to like a party because they worried of it getting shot up. You know, if you talk to older people such as, you know, yourself, Angel Snuff Nut 7 or older, they'll say they don't want to go out because it's too dangerous. So if we was to like deputize them, they could be at those parties to make sure nothing don't happen, because it's usually the youth. You know, I know we violent, you know, and some way we can be able to, like, give these OGs a way to say, like, if we can do something for them, they'll do something for us. And I know that vigilantism is illegal, because I mean, what I'm saying is on the lines of vigilantism. But I was wondering if there's some way the Mississippi campaign could bypass that, like, we create our laws that work for us, you know, because, you know, ain't nobody gonna help us. We the only people we got. We all we got. Nobody don't wanna. Ain't nobody else gonna help us.
Yeah.
So, if you know, like, also I learned from Pharaoh, and this is true, because when I was talking to certain people, they confirmed some of the stuff he was saying. When you get in prison, the gangs in there, like, because it really starts in there, and when you get up in there, you know, there's an old order, because the older ones, they usually run it. The younger ones just follow behind them, because on the streets, the younger ones, like when you talk to OGs, when they say they can't beat the young ones, because the young ones don't care. The young ones are killing them in broad daylight. You know, the old ones, because they more experienced, they like, man, I just did 30 years. If I kill you, I may go back. I may do another 30. It's not worth it for them, you know. But to the younger one, they don't care. They willing to throw their life away. So when they get up in that prison, it's like they can't run. They ain't got nowhere to go. So they surrounded. So the probability of them doing something in that is unlikely, because when you surround it, like, it's not outside, you can get away, you know. But when you in there with other people that's older and more experienced than you, you at their mercy. So I think, like, we need to use, I think the Mississippi campaign would be best for an OGs, because they can, you know, they'll have to babysit them. Get them to, like, you know, babysit these young ones, tell them to sit down, you know. And unfortunately, some of the young ones may have to, you know, they're going to have to leave. Because it ain't just nothing else. What I learned is not really like all of them. It's just that few in the game, you know, in the young ones. And it's they may have lost somebody. They just hate this other gang. And no matter what you tell them, they not going to listen. Mm-hmm. And I learned from Pharaoh, like, you going to have to shoot him. It's unfortunate, but he has to die, because it's the only way to get all of them to stand down. It's not all of them. It's just that one person, you know, or it may be that two people. But them, you have to get them out the way to get the rest to sit down. And, you know, it's just something I've been thinking about for a while to talk to you about. Because I know vigilanteism is it's illegal. But I think if we can deputize the OGs, then it can inspire black people. And then, like, that inspiration could create, like, the idea to, hey, you know, let's start policing ourselves. But I think it should be steps. I think first we should deputize the OGs to watch and control the young ones. Then, after that process is done, then we inspiring, you know, the younger ones to say, hey, you know what? I think I want to, since everything is okay here, maybe, you know, we can get on the police force. It would start policing our people. Because, I mean, it goes hand in hand with black businesses, too, as they say. You know, when you have a business, you have to create security. Because without security, you can't have business. So I believe, like, it should be like the Mississippi campaign should, you know, I think it'll help this if we can get it up and rolling. You know, it could be part of the process to, you know, as you say, healing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if it was just like some way, you know, because I talk to them, Agent Thunder 7, I really do. And if it was some way to help them, I think they would do it. But it has to be a real reason. It has to be something that we could do for them to say, hey, you know what, you do this, you know, we can help you do this. You know, we can help you fight these cases. We'll be there for you. It's like you said, like, if you have a problem in another state, we take the fight to them in that state. You know, mm-hmm. We'll be there for you. It's the same process. And it's something I always thought about. And it's the same. It's another thing I was thinking about, too. It's on the lines of this, but it's not really in the same topic range. But my uncle, he owns a security business. And I was thinking about it. I was like, I said, you know, why don't you, like, you know, start patrolling the neighborhood? Because the robbery situation is separate entirely, Andrew Snubnub 7. Now see, what I was learning, that a lot of people think it's just gang. Now you got a few out there that gangs out here that's robbing. And now I heard that it's like it's renegades now. Like it'd be like a gang of different gangs, like different people from different gangs, they all in one gang. So you got these like outlaws, renegades out here now. And now it's like, you know, I was telling my uncle, well, I never told him, but I was thinking about it, because the robberies, they not really, a lot of them, most of them, they not in no gang. They just a group. They just groups out here. They just robbing now. So I was telling him, I said, why don't you, like, let's say, like, you get the people in the neighborhood to patrol the community at night, because they usually, a lot of people, they do a night, they have night shifts. So if they can somehow get, you know, go outside and patrol the neighborhood, and you get the people to do that, because the people paying you, it'll be more black owned, and plus you got the people's interest at heart, and they'll be willing to like patrol the neighborhoods, and you have to be willing to, you know, shoot if necessary, because I think a lot of people are afraid, because these, just like the gangs and the robbers, they got these different kinds of guns, and they got automatics, so they gon', you know, like with different guns, you know, you got, you know, pistols, you got, you know, shotguns, you know, etc. But with these automatics, they shoot multiple bullets, so a lot of people gonna get hit, and most of the time they don't hit their targets, and they end up killing innocent people. Some people get killed just getting into an argument with somebody.
Yeah.
So I just think, like, I told him, like, man, you should, you know, try to do this, because you'll make more money and you'll have black people's interest, or people in general's interest, because, you know, different forms of people living at, you know, neighborhoods. But mainly our people, you'll have our interest, and you can get more connections. But I can only say and, you know, tell people this, but it's up to people to do it. And, you know, it's bad, Angel Snubnub 7. And like, yeah. I told you, I remember I was telling you about that story about Robert Youngby Sandifer. Do you remember him? I was telling you about Yummy. And I told you about that 11-year-old, you know, he was a gang member, but he was killing other gang members. And his last kill was a 14-year-old girl. He didn't mean to hit her. Her was an accident. And apparently, like, the law enforcement was looking for him. And I think Yummy's gang had, you know, figured out that if they captured him, that he was going to tell. So they had to get rid of him. And they end up, unfortunately, blowing his brains out in a underpass somewhere in the Hunnids in Chicago. He was a black disciple. But I'm saying that to you because his key is out here now. His little Yummy's out here now. I hear stories all the time about these kids, they killing that Andrew Snubnub 7. I'm talking about like a 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
Yes.
13. Like, it was one of my friends at work, you know, he told me a story about this. There was a pizza restaurant, and he had got a call from some kids. And what was actually happening was, when he went to their address, they tried to rob him, and they end up shooting him in both his legs. Some kids. You know, and I know that the gangs is using these young children to kill, and you just never know. Like, sometimes, you know, the police, they may be looking for an adult suspect. The whole time it was a little kid on the bike that shot somebody. And I know a lot of people don't believe me, but Oh, they won't believe this, but I mean, it's really out here now. And they say, some people say that Yummy was a rarity in the 90s. I don't think he was. Because I talked to people, they told me there was others. It's just more prevalent now. But there was, there may have been others, you know, like, you know, it's just that bad now. So,
yeah,
you know, well, I guess I conclude on this part, you know, I just thought I wanted to hear your thoughts, or, you know, if you wanted to live to come on, can, or anybody else in the chat, please voice your response or concerns, and, you know, you go ahead and take the floor, Angel Snuff Nuff 7.
Well, I had to go get me some paper because I wanted to take some notes while you talked. Sometimes you need to take notes when people talk a lot of times because you can't really remember certain key elements that you would like to talk on and you don't want to disturb. I don't want to disturb your flow. That's what you will see on a lot of platforms. People are very disrespectful. They want to cut you off while you're in the middle of a thought or whatever. When the only thing we have to do is get our pen and pad and take notes. And then when the brother or the sister finish talking, you can go back and speak on those points that you wanted to reflect on. You know, a lot of us are so disrespectful. And what that shows me is that the speaker is not really worthy of listening to. You listening so that you can comment to show that you're not really want to add on, because most times when you hear people that want to interrupt, they want to show that whatever they have to offer is more important. There's nothing more important than anyone that comes here and speak. You should be able to talk and you should be able to speak without somebody interrupting your flow. I've interrupted people's flows on purpose, those who are guilty of these things, to show them how it feels when you're talking and then somebody interrupts you and break your flow. That's frustrating. Because you're talking and you got a flow going on and somebody, I don't mean to cut you off. If you don't mean to cut somebody, why don't you just shut up to begin with? Get your pen, get your paper, and put down some notes. And when they are finished, then you see. And that's what I want on this platform, because I'm not smarter than you. We are learning together in our experience. There really is no right. There really is no wrong. We're trying to figure this out. So you allow this brother or you allow this sister to speak their piece. Whatever you have so important, it can wait. And then when you speak and talk, nobody will break your flow. You can express yourself. And so we see on these, a lot of these platforms, we see people arguing, going back and forth. They're not accomplishing nothing. So at the end of the 4-hour live stream, at the end of the 6-hour live stream, what did we learn? We didn't learn a damn thing except disrespect. And usually a lot of cussing, vulgar language and things of that nature. Ain't nobody learning nothing. Nobody's mind has changed from where they originally. They ain't learned nothing. So I don't want to be guilty of that. But now the brother has given me the mic. So what I would like to add, most of us who follow this platform, you already know that I'm a victim of the criminal justice system. And they took 10 years of my life. I was never in a gang. I never was a criminal, although in my youth I did participate in what may be called criminal behaviors, but I was just a stupid child doing dumb things. A criminal is a person that is their purpose, and they have a history of criminal activity. That's a criminal. I was just a stupid brat out there doing dumb things. It could have been stealing. It could have been doing some kind of prank on somebody or whatever. Just a stupid brat doing dumb stuff. But I got caught up in a system with people who have committed some heinous crimes, from murder to rape to pedophilia. I was with people like that for 10 years. I heard Dr. Umar Johnson state, he's a clinical psychologist. And so since he's a clinical psychologist, mind you, he's never been locked up. He's never talked to gang members or nothing like that. He never, to my knowledge, he's never expressed. He talked to gang members or people with criminal backgrounds like that. He's a clinical psychologist speaking with children that have certain problems. But because he holds some kind of degree or whatever, I guess his conclusions is valid. And he concludes, like I believe, correct me, Brother Denzel, if I'm wrong, but Farrell said that also came to the conclusion that we're going to have to kill some of our people because they're just too savage. Now, that's correct. Okay. Now, I don't know how you determine these things, that we become judge, jury, and executioner. Who gives us the right without a trial? Because I never hear them mention about some kind of, we put them on trial, or we give them probation, we give them a warning. We just point out somebody and we think their behavior is outrageous to us, and we just simply, we're going to just kill them. Now, for me, that's unjust. With no trial, with no warning, no opportunity to change or to make a choice. So that kind of behavior, to me, that makes us just as bad as the Caucasian or those in this, in the criminal justice system that oppress us, because they do the same thing. They tell us that we're innocent until proven guilty, and we're doing the same thing. We want to be a vigilante and kill something because they don't fit our criteria, and you don't give them an opportunity, a warning or a trial or something. I don't like you. You're doing bad stuff. I'm going to kill you. And I have a personal problem with that, because when you talk about taking somebody's life, if you're going to do that, then taking their life, you really should be able to justify it. Not because they stole a pack of bubble gum. You should be able to prove that they were worthy, or you thought they was worthy, or you was justified in murdering them, because that's what it would become. You become a murderer. And this is the problem with us in the society with these races. We don't have proper trials. We don't have opportunity to defend ourselves. We go in here, they are judge, jury, and executioner. And I would not want to be like that. This is the problem that I had also with, and it's a little off topic. This is the problem I had with the Malcolm X case. the Nation of Islam purposely did not give that man an opportunity to defend himself and to make a case for himself, even though that's part of the teachings, that you are supposed to be able to go before the body and explain your position. They denied him that because when you go to trial, other things come out. And the other thing that would come out, had Malcolm been able to defend himself, there would be no argument, there would be no debate. Simply, since Malcolm is a liar, let's see those sisters' birth certificates, if they are teenagers, underage women. And that then Malcolm is a liar. Actually, the trial would make the Nation of Islam look even better, because they would have shown that Malcolm X was a liar, because these women would have not have been underage. Malcolm, you're a liar. Here's their birth certificate. But see, the problem is they know. So I don't want to be like them. Also, my experience of 10 years with pedophiles and murderers and gang members, I was in the locked up with all these people. No child is born, and I've never heard a baby say, I want to be a gang member when I grow up, sell drugs and shoot people. I've never heard a child say that. I never heard a little girl say, when I grow up, I want to be a prostitute, get my putty tat and make money from men. I've never heard these things. How can you be a lover? How can Dr. Umar Johnson, how can Farrell say that? How can you be a lover of us and you ignore our condition and where we come from? Now, maybe you come from a decent family, and maybe your life has been a bed of roses. Some of our people, young people, was orphans. They lost their parents. Some of their parents was drug addicts. Some of their parents was criminals locked up in jail. Some of them was exposed to the criminal element. They was raised by criminals. We don't know the background and why the sister or the brother got caught up. They got caught up in something. Some of our children are taught by adults criminal behavior from the very beginning. It's a way of life. That's what they know. So some of us come up in these different environments and we choose a different role. But many of us, we get caught up. And unfortunately, we go in a bad direction. When these Caucasian people, when their criminals get caught up in murder, in rape and robbery, As you know, they don't go around condemning their criminals. They will sit you in a car and buy you a cheeseburger, and you just shot 8 people. What's his name? Dylan Roof, for an example. Gave him some Whopper, gave him a cheeseburger. And then when they go to court, they don't condemn their people. They talk about, oh, he had a bad childhood. His mama was a crackhead, a meth fiend, and daddy was a prison. They go to the root of the problem. We automatically condemn our people, knowing that many of us come from bad backgrounds. If your mother is ignorant and your father is ignorant, what kind of children are they going to raise? ignorant children. We just talked about this on a live stream not too long ago in the early 80s, right along with the crack epidemic, there was the black teenage epidemic. So many of us was raised by children. So if you are 35, early 40s or whatever, right now, many of these was raised by children. Their mother was 14, 15, 16 years old. What is that child gonna give to an infant? You have grown people, men and women, that don't have children until they are 25 and 30. They barely can do anything and teach a child anything. What the hell is a 15-year-old gonna teach a baby? So there's a lot of things, there's a lot of factors here that we don't take in consideration. Some of our children, some of our people were sexually abused as children. Some of them began using drugs at 9 years old, maybe 7. I've seen people give their children beer and alcohol and they was infants and laugh. I seen somebody give a baby beer and the baby, you know, acting drunk. Should have called child services. But you have those type of cases. So we don't know the backgrounds of people. And this is not making an excuse, because once you commit murder or whatever you do, you're going to have to suffer the consequences. But at the same time, if we are just people, if we are compassionate people, we should begin to understand that person, because that's not the only one. There are other powder kegs waiting to explode. And that's what we're seeing right now in our children, in our youth. These are powder kegs that was built up. Now they are exploding. Not only in our community, but in the Caucasian community, even in other communities, there are powder kegs waiting to explode because this is building up in them. All this to say, I spent time with the criminal. And I know, and I got to know the criminal. A lot of people, even when they commit murder, a lot of people, they get caught up. But when you talk to them, they're nothing but another human being like you and me. If you minus the crime or the charge and just look at people as a human being, folks get caught up. Because this environment can cause us to get caught up. What do you tell a person, or how can you tell a person not to steal and they hungry? How can you tell a person not to steal and they are in an environment of materialism and they don't have nothing and they don't have the skill to get something? Then they are going to steal. They are going to rob. And we always talk about the physical crimes of murder or rape. What about those that steal our money, what they call it, the white collar crimes? And they murder your bank account. And they scam you. What about the white collar crimes? We focus on the physical crimes of murder and so forth. But if somebody murdered your bank account, that's almost like killing some of you too, because we need money. We need funds in order to survive. How do you feel if somebody can con your grandmother out of her life savings? But that person who murdered her bank account, but they're not treated or not as viewed like somebody that actually took a life. But when your grandmother or older person is dependent on their social security check and what they say in order to survive to the rest of their life, you might, that's almost like murder. You done killed their bank account. And we have people in the black community, these preachers and these pastors and reverends, they do it every day. Nobody looking at them as a criminal. That's criminal behavior. Dr. Umar Johnson took all this money from the people. I'm gonna promise you a school. 14 years, no school. And he's given a pass. But he's gonna turn around, kill the gang member. He's killing your bank account. Take your money. Negro, you need to go to work and get you a job. Why are you taking people's money and you're not producing nothing? That's fraud. That's criminal behavior. And the criminal, this criminal, who is guilty of a white collar crime, has the nerve to judge somebody else and talk about, we need to kill them. What about you? Just because your crime is white collar, you should be killed too then. Equal opportunity death. And it's a lot of these people out here taking money, scamming, killing people's bank accounts. Kill them too then. Since y'all want to murder, nobody gets a trial. You don't get a chance to defend yourself. So I have a problem with that type of mindset, because we need to show compassion to ourselves. These other people show compassion to their murderers, their pedophiles, while we can't show mercy to ourselves. We want to condemn because we want to show how righteous we are. Holy we are. So before we do anything, and this has been tried. The Nation of Islam, and it's probably videos on YouTube that you can see. There has been attempts ever since the 1980s. There was a truce between the Bloods and the Crips going all the way back to the 1980s. Hell, they was making music videos together for a while, going back to the 1980s. But see, the problem is you have the Nation of Islam and you have others who get these gang members to the point where they are willing to dialogue and willing to change and do different. But you have nothing to offer them. The only thing you can tell them is, y'all need to stop killing each other. Y'all need to stop. Let's be brothers and sisters. And the gangs, a lot of those gangs, some of them say, yeah, let's try. Okay, we tried it. And I'm broke. I'm trying it. And I don't have nothing. A lot of times, like if you smoke cigarettes, some of us can quit cold turkey. Like my mother. My mother was able, she turned it on and off. She could quit when she felt like it. But then there are those like President Ronald Reagan. He used jelly beans. Instead of smoking, he ate jelly beans. We are in a situation where our people are weak in the mind. Most of us are weak in the mind. That's why we are obese, That's why we can't really do nothing because we don't have any discipline. We're weak. So we need a crutch. That's why you hold on to religion. That's why you hold on to spirituality. That's why you hold on to a lot of the things that we hold on to because we're weak. We need something to embrace us. We can't stand on our own two feet. We're weak. So I don't get angry at the people I talk about because I understand that you're weak. You can't be like me because I stand on mine. I don't need a crutch. I'm not sick. What was it that Jesus said? Only the sick need a doctor. I'm not sick. So these people are looking for doctors because they know they're sick or they are a hypochondriac. They believe they are sick. So you want the gang members, you want people to do this and that. So what are you going to do to replace those things? And you give them nothing. So these alliances, these treaties, they fall apart because you have nothing to give them. So they go back to doing whatever the hell they was doing because they're not going to work at McDonald's for $5 an hour. They're not going to do that. They're not going to sweep floors for $7.50 an hour. They're not doing that. You have nothing to offer, but you raise millions of dollars for your leaders to live good in mansions and beautiful. Some of your leaders, the people that you support, don't even live in the hood. They actually live with white folks. I know Tariq Nasheed, I believe he lived with white folks. And Young Pharaoh purposely moved to the white folks. He said, Negroes is crazy. He gonna live, and he feels safe with the white folks. And how do Young Pharaoh and Tariq Nasheed live with the white folks? By begging black folks, by black money. That's how they live with the white folks. And this is what we support. You get what you pay for. So, people need a crutch. Unfortunately, people need a crutch. And we don't have no crutch for them. So the only thing we can complain, not only you don't have a crutch, but you don't even have another environment for them to go that's better for them. You don't keep a crackhead in a crack house and think they're going to get better. You don't let somebody who have a problem with overeating give them a job in a restaurant. So you have these people, you want them to do better, but their condition, their environment is still the same. And then because they need a crutch, you can't give them a crutch because of your self-righteousness, you don't understand. So let's kill them. Without a trial, without a warrant, without a warning, anything. I cannot do that. There was a, and probably Brother Denzel can remember, because I know they concentrated in the Cabrini Green housing project in Chicago. In the late 80s, early 90s, there was something the Nation of Islam, once again, I'm mentioning the Nation of Islam again. There was a program called the Dope Buster. And the Dope Busters, the fruit of Islam, who did not carry guns or no kind of weapons, they was able to go to these violent housing projects in Chicago and I believe in Baltimore and different places. This made the news. They were able to talk to the gangbangers and other people. They didn't carry no weapons. They just talk to our brothers. They just talk to our sisters like you had some damn sense. I know I did. I had a gun put to my head. It was a gang. I forgot what the name of the gang in East St. Louis, Illinois. I was a Muslim. I went and talked to them. I wanted to talk to their leader in person. And one of the young gangbangers didn't want to hear that Muslim crap. Put a gun to my head. Nigga, I'll blow your brains out. Even though he threatened me like that, I just told him, well, I guess it's my time to go, bro. It's just my time to go. I was just trying to come in here and talk to us because, you know, trying to help our people out. That's all I was in here. If that cost me my life, so be it. He changed his mind. And he came to the mosque the week after that happened. And you know what they told me? They told me after the meeting, them Muslims is fake. See, I proved myself with them. And those young people respected me. Matter of fact, I was a young people too at the time. I think I was 19, 20 years old. That's what they was. They was young people. We was all young folks. But after the meeting, because they came to the meeting for me, out of respect for me. And they thought I would be the speaker that day, which I was scheduled. I was assistant minister at the time, also. They was like, they're not gonna let you speak. And then another brother took my place. And I don't know how many of you been to a black Muslim meeting or anything. You listen to Farrakhan and they huff and they puff. They put their chest out and God gonna do this and blah, blah, the power and blah. After the meeting, I met those brothers and sisters after the meeting. And they told me that they, Negroes is fake. Now, of course, I didn't like that. They might, you know, at the time, you know, it's my brothers, you know, in there. But they said, hey, Negroes is fake. Never did see them again. And see, this is another thing. Some of our people will tell you in your face, you fake. And after a while, they know if you real or not. Some of us are fake. And this is the reason why a lot of them not getting on board with none of this stuff. I'd rather keep doing what the hell I'm doing because the only thing they want to do is take them and use them. I'm not selling no damn bean pies on the corner. I'm not going to all praises due to Allah and worship some damn God. They're not going to do that. They don't want to hear all this religious mumbo jumbo. I'm a Moor. I'm a Hebrew Israelite. These people don't want to hear that stuff. It's all about how can my life be better? How can I survive? And if you ain't talking real stuff to me, I don't want to hear it. You just want to use me. Right now, I'm making the ducats. I might not live long. I'm driving the I got what you got, Farrakhan. I'm driving a Mercedes Benz. I'm eating good food. Yeah, I might not live that long. So what? I might go to jail. So what? I don't care. This is the kind of mentality that you're dealing with. I'm not going to let you use me. Because they will tell you, gang, recognize gang. This is why it's important for Mississippi campaign. So that we can take our people out of these environments. Because you cannot heal a crackhead in a crack house. But that's going to cost money. And did the leadership want to live good? That money should be going to helping the people that you claim that you love. Instead of living high on the hog. But that's what they want to do. That's their purpose. We suffer together. If I'm sleeping on the floor, we all sleep on the floor. We all come up together. There is no, what they said, big eyes and little U's. We all on the same level. But there's always going to be better. Somebody better. You don't look at us as a people. We all should be doing this. And see, the sad thing is that in the Nation of Islam, they teach whatever a brother have, half of it belong to your brother. They don't practice that. Who is Louis Farrakhan sharing with? Who is Umar Johnson sharing with? Who are these people sharing with? It's all for them. And these people in these games not going for it. Matter of fact, they will blow your brains out before they let that happen. It's not going to happen. Because you're not real. And then y'all suckers, you keep everything, you do everything you can to keep folks from listening to people like myself. Because I keep it real. Because I'm not tripping on living in a fancy house. If I want to live in a fancy house, we all live in a fancy house. I don't trip on material thing. But see, your idea of success is material thing. My idea of success is I have a real friend. I have a real brother. I have a real sister. That's my success. Real family. When I was growing up, we was poor. But we had each other, we had ourselves. We didn't have a fancy car, beautiful house, had a tin house, a shack. But we was happy and we was content. As long as we have ourselves, we was there for family, was there for ourselves. Our family start falling apart when people start seeking material crap. That's when families start falling apart. Because we believe material things is success. The swimming pool, the big house. Trying to live like white folks. Trying to live like the Peckerwoods that you claim you have a problem with. You're trying to live like them. And you talk like them. And you behave like them. But they the problem, they're supposed to be the enemies and you're trying to be like them. So they don't feel family coming from you. They feel a bunch of idiots that want to use them. And most cases, you are quite correct because that's all you're going to do is get used. And they're not going to go for it. I'd rather live my life for me for 20 years, for 15 years, at least I lived it for me, not to benefit your happy, greedy ass. Mr. Big Shot Leader, you have the nerve to talk killing me. Come with it, Negro. Come with it. Ah, we gonna come and kill you. Come bring it. Bring it. So the Mississippi campaign is a vessel that needs to be made real so they can have a place to go. So we can get them out the crack house. So we can get them out the liquor store. You need a change of environment. But that's a lot of sacrifice. And you don't want to do that. And there's an element that want to control the environment. We want to make the environment Muslim. We want to make the environment Hebrew. We want to make the environment Pan-African. All that foolishness. Because their intent is not really to heal the people. Their brotherhood comes with strings attached. They really want you to become part of their garbage. That's what it's about. They're not really for the people because this situation We could have ironed this out and dealt with this way back in the 80s. But all these groups, they are about for themselves. They're not, they don't care about the people. They are just trying, like we say here on this platform all the time, a bunch of suckers trying to get use us like other people use us to get us on their slave plantation. That's why they don't like Angel Snuffing Up Seven. I'm not trying to get you on a slave plantation. You can live rich if you want to. That's not for me. If that's what makes you feel good. Because that's not for me. I'm not materialistic. Never have been materialistic. I don't want you on my slave plantation. I want you to be able to be free and liberated. And you should be in a position to make your own laws and control some water, control some land. Be able to do your, learn how to govern and do your, be independent for yourself for a change. Which a lot of times, which that's not going to hardly be possible because we don't understand independence. Now, if you want to be independent, this is the reality of being independent. That means if we took control of a state of Mississippi, that means we can only eat the food. We can only use the things that we produce, that Mississippi can produce. You don't import stuff. But see, we like caviar. And we like bananas and oranges. Mississippi can't grow oranges and bananas, caviar, unless it's some carp caviar or something like some cheap stuff. At one time, if you do your history, if you go back 100 some years, a lot of the communities in the United States, a lot of them was independent. They only used what they was able to grow and produce in their communities. Even when I was growing up, we only had bananas and oranges and Brazil nuts and stuff like that only during Christmas. Because we can't grow bananas and oranges. A lot of peaches and green beans and stuff like that. If we can't produce it, we don't need it. Y'all can't live like that. You want stuff that comes from thousands and thousands of miles away from you. That's the kind of situation that we're in. But if Mississippi wants to be really independent and keep most of the money, you have to become independent. That means the people have to understand made in Mississippi. If Mississippi can't produce it, then we don't need it. Y'all can't live that way. But if you want to be independent, you have to condition your mind and be there. If you want special stuff on our holidays, we can get bananas. You can get you some lobster now and then or whatever, anything that we can't produce. We can get that. That's a special treat now and then. But just like the United States is dependent upon China and Taiwan and other foreigners. There was a time when the United States produced everything the United States needs. Now the United States has become a dependent nation on imports. And a lot of nations around the earth have messed themselves up because they need imports. How can you call yourself independent, but you can't live, you can't function without help from somebody else, imports from somewhere else? That's not independent. And really, you get stronger that way. When you just depend on yourself. If Mississippi can't produce it, if Mississippi can't grow it, we don't need it. So my grandmother told me during the Great Depression, it really didn't bother them because they grew. They basically was independent as a sharecropper. They had hogs and chickens and cows, and they grew most of their vegetables, and we had pecan trees and apple trees. And they also knew how to recycle stuff. They didn't throw nothing away. We throw all kinds of good things away. Believe me, when my family threw things away, you couldn't use it no more. You couldn't use it. These people right now would pay thousands and thousands of dollars for old quilt my grandmother made out of old clothes. They pay thousands and thousands of dollars for quilts like that. But this is where we find ourselves. Why you want to talk about killing people, talking about who gives you the right and why? You want to murder our people. Talk to our people like you got some damn sense. I don't care if they're a murderer or rapist or whatever the hell you think they are. We are all human beings. And I know from my own personal experience, because I was locked up with that kind of people for 10 years. And I was able to assemble them. Here are people that's supposed to be insane. They're supposed to be criminals. I was able to talk with everybody so I can make our life better in that hellhole and fight for our rights. Here you are, supposed to be free with supreme wisdom, and you don't know how to talk to nobody. That's because you bring in some damn game. I sincerely cared about everybody in that place and justice being brought to us. You, I did not have strings attached. You have strings attached. You want to convert them to be a Moor or a Hebrew or a Muslim and stuff like that instead of wanting to actually really help people change their condition. And when I did that, I wasn't looking for booty. I wasn't looking for money or anything. And people would give me gifts. Like Jordan shoes, different clothes, or whatever. I didn't ask them for nothing. They just wanted to show appreciation for fighting for us. No strings attached. So I don't know, Brother Denzel, if my commentary helped you or not.
You all good. Continue.
Yeah, I don't know in my commentary. I just look at these things differently because we got to get out of this self-righteous mindset, because I know I had to do it for me. I always used to ask myself why so-and-so can't do this. When I was locked up, I asked why so-and-so can't do this and why so-and-so can't do that. They're not me. Some of those people I was locked up with could barely read and write. How the hell are they going to file papers to help themselves in the court and you can barely read and write? I was fortunate I could read and write pretty well. They couldn't do that. I was not addicted to drugs and alcohol. Many of them were addicted to drugs and alcohol. Many of them, because of those psych drugs, their whole persona was slowed down. They can't even think. They're not me. I was the only one in that place that could do what I done. They could not do it, because if somebody could do it, maybe somebody would have done it way before I showed up. They cannot do it. So we have some hypocrisy and some fakeness going on, because you claim that you want people to do better, but you don't understand why they can't do better. They're not you. Some of us had beautiful parents and we live comfortable lives. We went to college and got a degree. We're doing pretty well. Everybody's not that fortunate. We have to understand that. And before you condemn somebody, why don't we have some compassion for people? We talk about, I love black people, blah, blah, blah. I would even use myself for an example. There are a lot of folks that, for some reason, they hate Angel Snuff Nuff 7. They don't like what I say or whatever. Why don't you have compassion for me? Why don't you say, I wonder, why don't you ask yourself, I wonder what made him crazy like that? Why don't you ask yourself that? And see, when you are mentally ill, when you suffer mental disorder, you're not responsible for your actions. So I'm not, if I'm insane and crazy, I'm not responsible for my actions. But see, you, since there's nothing wrong with you, and you get caught up, then whatever you did on purpose. Because you're not crazy like Angel Snuff Nuff 7. You're not insane. Like, there's nothing wrong with you. Even though you believe in spaceships gonna come and save us, you follow dead people, Marcus Garvey, Malcolm X, Elijah Muhammad, you follow, I don't know how y'all do it, but you follow dead people, follow Jesus that never existed. But Angel Snuff Nuff 7 is the crazy one. You believe in all this fantasy, fiction, fairy tale, spooky stuff. You believe you can't die. The flesh dies, but you're not going to die. You're going to turn into some kind of energy, because energy never died, and you're going to float your happy ass through the universe. But Angel Snuff Nuff 7 is the one crazy. You ain't never lived in Africa, but you are African. You was born and don't know nothing except the United States of America, but you are African. But Angel Snuff Nuff 7 is crazy. You don't know nothing about Africa, period. But Angel Snuff Nuff 7. You never been, you never met a real Hebrew, you never met a real Moor, and even the Africans, some of them will call you fake. They call you white people. I see it on video. And you look stupid trying to argue because these people are Africans and they're telling you in your face, you white man. And I saw the brother and the sister trying to explain, no, we African. And the only thing those people said, you are a white man. You don't know how to explain. I'm an African, you white man. See, here, we on this platform, we don't have to go through that nonsense. You're supposed to be a Muslim, and those Arabs tell you, you a fake Muslim, you ain't real. And you gotta sit around here and try to explain how you real. Because it didn't come from you. You got it from them. They should know if you real or fake. You fake. Because if you're not doing it the way they brought it, then you fake. That's fake stuff. That's not your Islam. Don't belong to you. None of that. None of this stuff that we get came from us. Christianity, Islam, the Hebrew stuff, all this stuff didn't come from us. It came from somebody else. You get away with this Egyptian stuff because those people don't exist no more. Because if they was alive, they would tell you, we ain't related to you. Just like a lot of these Africans tell you in your faith. You ain't related, I ain't related to you. You white man. And we look so stupid caught up in this mess because that's not us. And you live in denial. You can't accept the truth from the people themselves when they tell you in your face, you're not us. I had a brother in the Sudan that came from the Sudan. He was driving a taxi cab. I asked him, are black Americans Africans? He said, no. He said, they think they are. And he come from the Sudan. He's an African. And you look stupid trying to argue with him. He tell you in your face, no. He said, we can be brothers and sisters, we can be You know, we can be family in because of our oppression, but we're not related like that. I saw a person who lives in Africa, their comment on a post. And their comment was, Black Americans aren't African simply because they wasn't born there. You don't have no citizenship in no African nation. And the corny thing is, if you're such an African, why don't you give up your citizenship of being American and take your happy ass and go and be an African in Ghana? They travel to Africa, but they don't give up their American citizenship. You such of an African, and you hate America so much. Why don't you give up, denounce, because you can do that. You can denounce your citizenship. And and this government will treat you like the African you claim you want to be. But they don't do it. Because you know better. You only fool yourself. You only fool yourself. But dealing with this issue here, we still don't have compassion for ourselves. It would take a hell of a lot for me to come before us and tell you, yeah, let's kill so-and-so, let's murder so-and-so. Especially without a trial. Especially without a warning or anything. We just gonna, because of what we think, how we feel. Oh, that's a bad seed right there. But you don't give a brother or a sister an opportunity. You don't give them a chance. You are just like the oppressor. You ain't no different than the oppressor is. Matter of fact, you might get more compassion from them. Well, what are your thoughts, brother Denzel?
Oh, well, my bad. Andrew Snowden 7. You said a lot of things I agree with. I'm glad that I'm actually having this conversation. I've been wanting to have it with you for a while. So, but you know, I wanted to come over. I didn't want to come on this show empty-handed without stuff. So, yeah. But I do respect you, man. I really do. Yes, I learned a lot from you. And when you were saying we should have compassion for each other, I agree with that. Cause some of the OGs I'll be talking to, man, you be surprised. Two of them, their childhood was terrible.
Yes.
It was terrible. One of them told me that, you know, like both his parents was on drugs. And it was other children like him. And he used to knock on other people's doors so they can to ask, could they take care of him? And nobody would do it. You know, and even with Yummy, I heard Yummy was abused. I heard some stories. They say he had cigarette stains on his hands. And if you look at a picture of him, there ain't really no like baby pictures or nothing. It's just his he was supposed to be locked up because I think back in the 90s, it was easier for a kid to get out of jail than it is now.
Yeah.
And yeah, if you look at his mugshot, he looked very mean. Like you could tell something is off about him. You know, it's sad what happened to him. You know, and that's why I agree. You know, I understand, like, you know, our environment. And I never told you this, Andrew Snutnut 7. What makes me relate to them, I understand, like, some people being an orphan, because I was an orphan.
Yes.
I never told nobody, but I have a sister I'll be talking to on the game sometimes. So, you know, I don't like to be on social media a lot, and she a gamer. She older than me, but sometimes I got a game, and I don't be on it a lot, but sometimes I'll be on it with friends or I want to talk to her. And She told me things, man. Things I couldn't believe, but I'm not surprised, but I couldn't like I couldn't believe because you know, when you memory usually it leaves somebody, but when you start hearing, when I started hearing things, things slowly started to make sense. You know, I found out my real mother had, I have like 10 brothers and sisters that I only know like I only know like 5 of them. I don't know the other ones. So she told me my mother used to leave me with our grandmama, and my grandmother was on heroin. So I understand, you know, like I understand. I could have easily been outside if I was never adopted. I was in foster care. I remember all that. You know, I actually remember, like, I think I was abused too. I used to get whoopings because I didn't answer my homework wrong. I remember all that. And I didn't know, I didn't understand it because I was young, but now that I'm thinking about it now, like, mm-hmm. Yeah, I understand that, you know, people come from terrible backgrounds. So I understand. That's why I have compassion. But the thing I understand about like the OGs, I wasn't saying that we should go and kill them. I was never producing that. I'm just saying,
yeah,
we deputize them to help them like control them because they understand them more than us, because they were once them. So they understand them more. They can be able to help them more, you know?
Yeah.
And you know, like I said, there's, because you know, youth parties can sometimes get out of control. But if you have the OGs there, because you know, amongst the youth, it ain't all the youth, but amongst them, you got certain individuals that are, you know, a part of that lifestyle. So if we have them there, they can be able to tell them, like, keep them under control. You don't have to kill them, just keep them under control. Like, hey, I know you got a gun, but you know, you need to chill out, you know, come with me. Let's, you know, they'll give you something. Let's get something to eat. Let's talk, you know, stuff like that. Because when they see from now, what I be seeing now, if they see their opposition, if this is just gang violence, if they see their opposition, they gonna shoot. They don't care who they're. They don't. And I, Andrew Snutnut, so you be surprised. I got friends right now. They be trying to get me to go outside with them. And one of them, He a Blackstone. So, and one day I asked him, I said, hey, you ain't got no enemies out here. He said, no, but thanks for asking. And I looked at his car had bullet holes in it. So I'm like, I don't think I'm getting the car with you no more. I don't think I'm gonna do that. But he just like me though. He like the same things I like. And I was thinking about, cause he play video games a lot. And I was thinking about having a start in the tournament. I know I keep saying stuff. It's hard. It's a lot of things. I'm glad I'm having this conversation with you, Andrew. I could tell you what's going on a little bit with my life. I wanted to start this game tournament so I can give him a way out. You know, instead of him having to be outside, you know, he can come do this. You know, I ain't got it up and running, but I got a lot of stuff to do, but I wanted to do that because I understand how what this lifestyle do. And
yeah,
it's I don't really condone killing. And see, a lot of I had a cousin that told me, hey, because I almost got robbed. I remember I did tell you about that. I almost got robbed. And I try to show compassion to people. Like, And people would call me stupid, but I remember one day I was coming to work. I was gonna go to work and I had to go to the gas station. I leave early, you know, like around 5. And I rode up to the gas station. It was these two guys up there. Now, see, I knew they was, you know, something was off about them. But, you know, I don't like to judge my people. But
yes,
these two individuals, You know, some people say I'm stupid for this, but I decided, you know what? I shouldn't be that judgmental. I let them in my car and they tried to jack me for it. They was younger than me, Andrew Snubnub 7. I fought them off. And that was my error. I learned from it. And see, in my mind, like, man, I wanted to hurt them. But I didn't, you know. But I was in that mind state. Like, because these situations, because that's another thing that goes along with what you're saying, because these environments can mess your brain up. And, man, I was having thoughts like, man, I want to, man, I was thinking about hurting them, like, bad. But, you know, I didn't. You know, I just did the right thing. You know, one of them left his phone in my car, so I just gave it to the police and said, hey, man, y'all go deal with that. And I just left it alone. But I understand, and I understand, like, sometimes, even with the gang violence, it's like, it's something Pharaoh said that I had to think about. If I go talk to a dude, and let's say, like, I'm slowly starting to pull him up out the street, you know? But let's say he got a brother, and his brother just got killed. At that specific moment, he's fueled up. He wants vengeance. How am I going to talk to him? You know, because he'll be so angry, he'll kill me just for trying to stop him from doing that. He will do it. He would kill me. What am I going to do? You know, like, what am I going to do about that? You know, like, how am I supposed to stop him from going out there and throwing his life away?
Yes.
Like, that's why I say these kind of conversations, I don't know. Like, I don't know. Like, I guess it's hard sometimes to make a decision because, you know, I understand they come from bad situations and we should make a better way from them.
Yeah.
A better way for them to, you know, to live better so they don't have to experience these things. And now you got kids out here that's already killing. Like, and see, they say Yummy was a rarity. He wasn't.
Mm-hmm.
He wasn't. Back in those days, back in the 90s. But I never heard of stuff like this, Angel Snubnub 7. Like, it took me, I known about this for 2 years, about kids, little kids out here killing. I'm like, where did this come from? And they're more in numbers now. Yummy was probably, you may get like every 10 blocks or 5 blocks, you may get a Yummy back then, but now it's like, you know, it's out of control. Yeah. And it's still rare, you know, now. Like, you're not going to see them, like, where I live at, you may not see them often, but they're out there. And sometimes, I'm of the opinion sometimes that I don't think violence is the answer. Because I did, my cousins, when I told them I got robbed, they said I should get a gun. And I told them, I started thinking about it. And see, I found out some stuff about these robbers. They in groups now, Angel Snubnub 7, as I said before. And a lot of them got automatic guns. They got automatic weapons that shoot multiple rounds. And there have been stories about people who, the victims, who shot first and still died and got robbed.
Mm-hmm.
So what difference does it make me having a gun? Because if they got their guns pointed at me, my gun is useless. And some of them now is like, what I'm hearing now, Andrew Snubnub 7, is it shoot first. They will kill you for that car. The carjackings is up in Chicago. They will kill you for that phone, your shoes, everything. And they young, Andrew Snubnub 7, some of my age all the way down.
Yeah.
And see, that's why I understand poverty is bad. And I don't, and you don't really know the conditions of some of these people. And some of them are going through some terrible things.
Yes.
Some of them are going through terrible things, but I also know that some of them are not going to want to change. Some of them are not. It's unfortunate. It's unfortunate. Some of us are not, and I think that's also a reason because of the environment they in. Some of them ain't going to want to change. You know, it's sad. That's why, you know, it's kind of crazy. And then, you know, there was a video from Chief X where he was talking about, it's two things I learned about him. And I be really wanting him to come and have a conversation with you. But it's two things. He made a video saying that the youth was violent. Now, I told him, I agree with him on that part, but I also, there was another video where he was talking about the gun violence, right? Gun control, and why he's against it. And he was saying there was a video where he was looking. He was like driving in the area. He kept driving in this area, and he said he seen this fine looking woman, but she was married. And he was just looking at the house or the woman, as he say. I mean, we all know we black. We know he was looking at that woman.
Yes.
And one day he drove off, and he said a car, the husband came behind him and tried to get in a confrontation with him. And he said, man, this dude is willing to lose his life, you know, for, because I was looking at his house or looking at his girl. And, you know, in my mind, I'm thinking, because I got a friend who been in the same situation. And he worked at my job. He went to a gas station and he was looking at a girl, and that girl was somebody else's boyfriend. And he told him to stop looking, and Hightower didn't listen. My friend didn't listen. And the dude upped the gun on him. Now he was mad, but I was trying to tell him, like, man, look, you gotta come to work. You have to work. You can't be out there with them. You need to get your gas. You need to come back home. You got to watch your environment. I understand that, but like that you mad that this guy, you know, pulled a gun on you, but you shouldn't be out. You shouldn't be looking at no girls anyway. You need to focus on your job. You need to focus on getting, he had to get his car fixed too. You need to be focusing on these things. They are more important, because there's no point in getting into it with somebody and trying to kill him. Now you can't come back to work if you were to do that. And then you got to worry about this, that dude over there. He got homies. They find out that you killed him, they're going to want to kill you. So you can't show your face over here.
Uh-huh.
It'd be more detrimental towards you. And the reason I'm saying this, because Chief X, like if you have compassion for another brother, why was that dude following you? There are cases I just found out where they leave some type of liquid on somebody's car. If the woman touched that car, she'll pass out. They doing kidnappings, robberies, all kind of stuff. You know, like this man probably had this in his mind. He decided to follow you because, I mean, he don't know. And if you driving through there multiple times, I mean, what do you expect? You think if, because I know I live in Chicago, Andrew Snubnub 7. I know you know it more than me. You be on the block and you just start looking. You just driving in the same area and you just looking. I guarantee you they going to run your butt up off the block. They going to start shooting at you because they going to be like, who is this dude? Why is he over here? They think like that. And see, I think about, I don't know why he said that. Like, why would you even do that? I think the dude was wrong for chasing you, but if you was never looking to begin with, none of that would have happened. And see, that's why I say they talk, everybody always talk about the youth, but this is, look at their parents. Look at the behavior of the parents. And none of his followers called him out on that. And I started thinking, like, what is this dude talking about?
Mm-hmm.
People, I never understood that. I never liked that. Like, it's like I think there is a lot of things that's wrong with us that we gotta like fix, because it's you don't do nothing, no stuff like that. And I guess it's like you say, we over-sexualize.
Yeah.
You know, because I mean, he described the girl. He said she was bad. I mean, like we know how we black. We know how they be saying, like, dude.
Yeah.
And I know in Chicago, man, they would kill him. He did that over here. He'd make the news the next week. He'll make the news next week. Like I think Chief X is a good guy. I do. But it's just certain things I cannot respect him for what he say. Like you don't do say stuff like that. And his fans just eat it up. Like, yeah, he was here. Yeah, that man was wrong. I'm like, yeah, y'all don't go outside. Y'all don't be in Chicago. Cause I guarantee you do that stuff over here. I guarantee you. Man, they like and they really be like that Angel Snuck up over here. They don't do opposition. Beef, all that, they don't do that. You look suspicious to them, they will start shooting. My friends will tell you what I'm trying to tell you. They will shoot at you. Like, I also don't like, I remember what you were saying about they trying to, you know, like the Nation of Islam, the Hebrew Israelites, like how they try to get some of these people to join these organizations. Like Chief X always said that what is the left, because he's a conservative, he always said, what has the left done for you? And see, my man, and I see he got some type of point. But I said, what is the right done? Do you have a cell phone? You got a car? You got housing? You got an airlines I can get on? Since people like going to Africa, I mean, why don't you have your own airline so you can go there on your stuff?
Exactly.
You got a computer I can get on? You got a financial services? You arguing with me on somebody else's phone. So how much independent are you? But you want me to join your organization. And if he go, and I know some gang members, he go tell these young GDs that they gonna tell him, I think you should get off my block before I blow your brains out. They'll tell him that.
Yep.
They'll tell him that. And I mean, you know, like it is, I do. That's why I think the Mississippi campaign is just, I don't think a lot of people understand it, you know. Because I think people are content, you know.
Not trying to understand.
I think people are content.
They can understand it. They try to understand. They're not trying to understand. They're trying to push their narrative and their agenda. That's for them. It's a benefit to them. They're not really looking out. Like I said, it's not looking out for the people. They're just looking for people for their slave plantation. That's all.
Yeah. And it's right. And I just be thinking like, man, I got to talk to that lady. That lady, who, did you ever watch that video on the lady, the Freedom Bus Boycott? Andrew Snuff Nuff 7.
Video?
I did send it to you, but I'm gonna have to like talk to her on Facebook and try to see if she can come on. You could do a live with her, cause man, that lady needs to talk to you. Like she has similar ideas. Like what she's trying to do, she's trying to get black people to boycott businesses that don't respect us. Of these other people, you know, like the Asians, Indians.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think it's going to, you know, work. But she said to me that I like, she said, it's going to be hard.
Yeah.
You're not going to like to do it. And when she said that, I was thinking like, this sounds similar to what Andrew Snuff said be saying. Because the Mississippi campaign is going to be hard. It's going to require sacrifice.
Exactly.
It's the same thing.
Yeah.
You got to get her, like, you got to get have her on your show, Angel Stunner. So you need to have a conversation with her and see, you know, your ideas and see what she's talking about, and she can see what you talking about. I don't know. I gotta see how, you know. I'll probably see.
Well, I tell you, I leave a commentary on you know, I don't watch a lot of videos or whatever, but wherever I do, wherever I go, I always invite people, you know, to the platform or whatever. But a lot of folks, they're out for themselves. You know, they can't get, they're looking for praise and they're looking for credit for themselves. They're not looking, they don't care about what is in the best interest of the whole. All thing they know is they got something and you do what I want you to do. That's their attitude. They're not looking out. And they, you know, they look at me as competition. I ain't gonna help that nigga. Anybody that has anything can come here and say whatever they want to say. I don't trip. I'm not intimidated by nobody. But these people are intimidated. They don't want, they're doing everything they can. It's all for them. It's about them. Like I said, they want people from their slave plantation. That's all it's about. It's not even about the people. Because if it's about the people, then the people need to be involved and let them decide what they want to do. You don't want to give them a choice. Right. You only want to see you. You don't want to give them that choice.
And I was trying to... My bad, go ahead.
You only have like 10 minutes on this broadcast.
Oh, that's cool. My bad, Angel's Nothing at 7. Go ahead, finish. I'm sorry.
You only have 10 minutes. I want to answer this question. It's going to be real quick. I'll let you bring the conclusion. I just want to answer this because this is a real quick question. I don't even know if the person is still here to hear the answer, but I talked about this yesterday, actually. Where the comment at? What do I think about the Wagner or something like that? The Wagner, that thing in Russia that's happening in Russia? I think that... Here's the question. What about the Wagner group over in Russia? What is your thoughts? We talked about this yesterday. I don't have any thoughts. That's in Russia. That's their business. It's the same thing like you live in your house. Are you tripping on what your neighbors are doing? The only reason why you trip about what your neighbors are doing, if their dog is pooping on your in your yard, or they are doing something to disturb your property or whatever, you really don't trip on your neighbors. So here's Russia, thousands of miles away. And here we are, some powerless Negroes living in America. What the hell do I care? Why should we care about what happened in Russia? Unless America goes to war with Russia. Other than that, who cares? And that's just something we got to deal with because we have no power. We have no influence. So whatever happens, happens. You know, we talk about things and have no power. We talk like we free people that we control and influence something. And we don't. So that don't mean nothing to me. You can't even control and influence your own life right here domestically in America. So who cares about what the Wagner group do in Russia or what they do in Russia or the Ukraine? Who cares? It affects you because America, the country that you live in, gets involved. And you can't tell them people that's in charge what to do. They don't care enough about what you... Most black people, most soul brothers and sisters are anti-war. They don't give a damn about what you're talking about, what we're talking about. Because these are warmongers. That's because they want to use their weapons. They got these weapons sitting around not being used for years and years and years. They want to drop some bombs. They want to kill some people. That's the way these folks do. That's their history. That's what they do. They don't care about you anti-war. Hell, they don't even care about their own people anti-war. They don't care. The Vietnam War went for years and years and years. They didn't give a damn about those anti-war protests. The reason why they got out of Vietnam was simply because they was losing. Them people was kicking their ass. That's why they got out of Vietnam. Not because of anti-war demonstrations. With that said, brother Denzel, we got about 5 minutes. Go ahead, do your thizzy and take us out of here.
Uh, My bad, Andrew Snutnut. So I think I said enough, man. I think I said enough, man. And I know you busy. I don't want to keep you, man. I respect you. You be surprised. I learned a lot from you. I always keep that saying, want for others what you want for yourself. I love that saying. And if Deacons of Reality, is it still in the chat? I still ain't forgotten about what you about them t-shirts. Andrew Snutnut, so I know I keep saying it. I don't want you to think I'm making no excuses. Trust me when I tell you, I just got a lot of stuff going on. It's hard. But I'm going to get on it. I want y'all to stay on my butt about it, okay? That's all, man.
You
have a good one, man.
You see that little clip that we always play? Some people just like talking out their ass.
Yeah. That's why I said that.
You know, it's amazing how people, they always tell me this and that and that and that. And next thing you know, they gone. They don't do what they promised. Well, not promised, what they said is going to do or whatever. Like this one brother was talking about, I'm the new Elijah or something, stuff like that. And since I won't do what he want me to do, he's gone or whatever. See, because people be talking about out their ass. They want to use me for their purpose. They don't want to. They said that I'm some kind of Messiah or I got this going on, but they don't want to do it the way that the Messiah wants it needs to be done. They want to do it the way they feel it needs to be done. But I'm the Messiah. I'm the Elijah. I'm the prophet. But they don't want to do it the way that it's supposed to be done, but I'm the Elijah. And it don't make no sense. You know, people just talking about, I'm the new ancestor. I can hear the ancestors speak. Well, the ancestors telling you to do this, and why won't you do what the ancestors? Next thing you know, they disappear. People just like talking out their ass.
I know, man. I don't want to make no excuses with you, man.
And for me, it's not about you. You know, about you. I'm just talking about people in general.
No, I understand.
Yeah, I'm just saying us as a people in general, we just some confused. You know, we just go wherever the wind blows, and we emotional. We love emotional rhetoric, and we that's all we really are. We don't care nothing about substance, nothing that's tangible. You know, as long as you can make me feel good, you know, say some words and preach real nice, whatever, and we happy-go-lucky because Masa take care of us. You know, the reason why Chief X can do what he do because Masa take good care. You know, the reason why Pharaoh said that can do what he do because Masa take care. And the reason why Farrakhan and all these people can say and do and operate the way they do because Masa take good care of us. So you don't need that just nothing upset. Chief X don't need nobody. I just do my own thing. Everybody doing their own thing. And pretty soon, all of you going to end up with nothing. That's what's going to happen to you. Y'all going to end up with nothing. Because, like I always say here, the right thing that happens in the world, you will see things for what it really is. Because right now, we're living in illusion. The right thing that happens in the world, and people can actually show who they really are, you're going to find out. You think you're suffering and you think you're on the bottom now. You got a rude awakening coming to you. And you put yourself in a position where you can't defend yourself. You don't control no resources or nothing. You're done. The Mississippi campaign is the only thing that I know of that can try to put us in a position where at least we got a peace shooter to fight back with. We have absolutely nothing. We don't have nothing. And I'm not a savior or messiah. Brother Denzel is not your savior or messiah. If that's what you want to do, and if that's what you want to pass on to your children, so be it. And they're going to curse you one day because you had an opportunity to stop a lot of this suffering. And because of your selfishness and grandiosity and ignorance, you're going to pass this to... Now, you think the children are angry now. Wait till they suffer something that we probably never seen before, because it's coming around the corner. Things can always get worse. They might not get better, believe me, but things can always get worse. And what's worse is that we have to end this broadcast Thank everybody.
It's okay.
Yeah. Thank us. I want to thank you, Brother Denzel. And I want people to understand that Brother Denzel is a warrior for us. Brother Denzel is a supporter for us. And, you know, we're just joking around, but Brother Denzel is here for us. Brother Denzel is out here trying to do a little something for us. And I want a lot of us. You don't have to do a lot. Just do a little taste. Just do a little taste. Don't take a lot. Send the people to me. You know, you don't have to argue and debate with them. Bring them here. You don't have to argue and debate with nobody. Share the video. Just do a little taste. That's all. Don't take a lot. You know, it's just 10 of us, you know, 15 of us or whatever. I mean, we can't, you know, our little group can't do too much or whatever. But just do it a little. But like you, I stay on the case because you never know what might happen that changed the whole game. Oh, we got Brother Yanga in the house. What's up there, Brother Yanga? Now, Brother Yanga is a real warrior. And Brother Yanga is a real warrior, and I give Brother Yanga that because Sister Nandy proved it. So all that I can do is give credit. Brother Yanga threw down with the police, did the whole liberation type thing. He did it. Yeah. And they got it on film. It ain't no talk they threw down, him and Sister Nandy. So I got to give them, I'm going to have to, regardless, I give them their credit. I give all warriors their credit. But so many of y'all just talk bull crap. You ain't never did a damn thing in your life. You can't even share a video. And like we say here, we don't give credit unless you earn it. I don't give nobody no credit unless we earn it. So shout out to Brother Yanga. And to those who support Brother Yang and what, and I'm listening to Sister Nandy, and she bringing the receipts. I'm thinking I'm going back into the 60s, like for real. I'm thinking, but this was, I don't know what year all this was happening, but they was throwing down in Atlanta. But it made you remind you of the struggle that we was going on during the 60s. So I'm gonna give them that credit. No doubt. Warriors. I got to give the warriors their credit. You welcome, Brother Yanga. And we
peace to Brother Yanga.
Yeah, peace to Brother Yanga. And Brother Yanga, either I come to your platform or you can come here and we pick a topic. And we do our thizzy, but when it's all said and done, we shake each other's hand. You a warrior, I'm a warrior. We want the same thing, and we move forward and progress. We move forward. Leave all the, like I said, all the bull doo-doo folks, leave them behind. I'd rather be by myself than in the company of fake-ass people. I don't have enough of that. So on that note, we are out of time, unfortunately. On StreamYard, I'm using StreamYard. StreamYard only gives you 20 hours a month. And this is the end of that 20 hours. Yeah, so that's why I've been using a RestStream, because I knew I only had like 2 hours left on StreamYard. But anyway, you need to come back too, Brother Denzel. Whatever you want to talk about, we can bring that to the platform. And, you know, we just talk.
I just want to bring
something better.
Yeah. I just want to bring, make sure I have stuff to bring to the platform. You know, I don't like coming empty handed, Andrew Stunt 07.
Yes. Yeah. That's great. I'm glad to see and hear you, Brother Denzel. But Brother Denzel's a warrior for us. Don't get it twisted, y'all.
I don't think I'm a warrior. I just I'm trying to. I really do think about what you be saying, Angel Stunt 07, every day. I try to get people to watch you. Some of them say they don't care. I say, one of them, I had a conversation with him about the Mississippi campaign. He said, how would that affect your life today? I said, look, well, not mine. It's not about my life. It's about all of us. But he said, well, But
exactly.
Well, I don't want to keep you, Angel. Nothing. I know it's
rest. I mean, StreamYard just cut us off anyway. So on that note, thank you everyone for joining us this spontaneous broadcast. Thank you, Brother Denzel, Brother Yanga.
Thank you,
Black Superman,
Brother Yanga.
All our support, Brother Talib in the chat room also. Sister Tangie out there in California. Our people. Well, actually, we are worldwide thanks to the internet. Whether people like it or not, we are also worldwide too. Thank you so much for joining us. And as our ancestor, Dr. Neely, used to always say as a parting, we wish you love. Until next time, we wish you love, peace, and soul. We are
soul.
All exactly. That's us.
All right.